I'm too grateful to be here with all of you today. And with Gaur Purnima coming, we will discuss today on the topic of appreciating Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, especially of what we can learn about relational wisdom from him. Relational wisdom is wisdom about relationships. I'll talk about three A's: adversity, adventure, and advancement. And I'll be using this PowerPoint also as a whiteboard. So I'll be typing points as we move forward. And there are, of course, some things already in the PowerPoint. So the theme I'll be focusing on is about how Lord Chaitanya entered deep into the hearts of his devotees through the event that happened in their life and through his interactions with them. And similarly, we can also try to learn that principle of how to have sweet, loving exchanges. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Srila Rupa Goswami writes in the Upadeshamrita that sharing our heart and hearing others share their heart is one of the critical limbs of bhakti. So how Lord Chaitanya practiced that limb for that purpose. Now, the story of Sanatan Goswami, of course, both Rupa Sanatan Goswami and the other Goswamis also, this is a part of the most inspiring stories within the Gaudiya tradition. And Sanatan Goswami's story is actually involves more adversity and adventure than even Rupa Goswami. Various reasons. One reason is that they lived in a time of great challenge. Currently, the world is still reeling and recovering from the COVID pandemic. And as we are facing it, you know, we all get a glimpse of how difficult and unpredictable life can become. So Lord Chaitanya appeared at a time when life was similarly difficult and unpredictable, if not much more. That was the time when there was a tyrannical Islamic ruler, and he was devastating all the remains of traditional Vedic culture. And Rupa Sanatan Goswami very expertly acted as a shock absorber. They were very talented and competent, and they got positions as his administrators. So you're talking about the adversity here. So what happens is the adversity was in multiple ways. The biggest part of the adversity for them was that they were trying to do something good. See, generally for us, when we face some difficulty, then we have difficulties and then we have adversities. Adversities are severe difficulties. Then it's relatively easier to accept. And when anytime we face difficulty, it's difficult to accept. But if it's come because of some big mistake of ours, suppose we make a big mess in our job and then we are fired. Well, it's difficult to bear even then, but still, okay, I made a mistake. But if it's only a small mistake, so that is even more, less than sign means that is much more difficult to bear. The adversity seems even bigger. It seems even more unfair. So if it's due to some small mistake of ours, then it's even more difficult to bear. If it's due to no mistake of ours, then it becomes even more difficult to bear. I didn't do anything. Why am I going through this? Why am I suffering this? Then if it is due to some, if we leave alone, make any mistake, if you try to do something good and that gets us into trouble, then that becomes even more difficult. Why is this happening to me? I only was trying to help. So if it's due to some good deed of ours, it's much more difficult. And if due to some, if there's hugely good deed of ours, and then normally when we do something good, we expect something good in return. If we try to help someone and that person kicks us in the face or stabs us in the back, that becomes so much more difficult to bear. And if we try to do something, somebody a big favor for them, and then they hurt us, it's very painful. So that is the kind of adversity that Rupa Sanatan Goswami faced. They had served this Nawab faithfully, and they had acted like a shock absorber between his atrocious nature and the devotional culture of Bengal at that time. So he got them into his employment. And because he also needed competent people to administer the kingdom, so he let them have their space. In that space, they practiced their own bhakti, they protected the devotees, and they went on. But eventually, their heart's aspiration for Lord Chaitanya was so strong that they could no longer resist it. That they had to, they had heard about Lord Chaitanya, they wanted to know him, they wanted to be with him. And they just had to. So eventually, when they decided to surrender to Lord Chaitanya, Rupa Goswami and the two brothers were working together in tandem. But when Rupa Goswami decided he wants to renounce the world, the Nawab agreed reluctantly, but he agreed, okay, at least your brother is there and he will take care of the administration for me. But when Sanatan Goswami wanted to renounce the world, that time it was impossible. The Nawab got furious. And then what did he say? He said, "You cannot leave me like this. I have trusted you so much." See, in general, in any relationship, what happens is we all see how much we have done for the other person, whereas we don't see how much the other person is doing for us. And that is the difference between you could say broadly, a demanding relationship and a rewarding relationship. So in every relationship, we do something for others, and the other person constantly keeps reminding us, "No, I did this so much for you, I did so much for you." And they overvalue what they do for us. And they undervalue what we do for them. That's when relationships become extremely difficult. So every relationship, sometimes some people say some relationships work, some relationships don't work. Well, all relationships don't just work. They all require work. But how much work do they require? That depends on whether there is a reciprocation or there is no reciprocation in the relationship. If we are doing something for others and others are not doing something for others are not valuing what we are doing for them, then what happens is they start feeling you're doing nothing for me, I'm doing so much for you. And that's when things become difficult. So what happened is, from the Rupa Sanatan Goswami's perspective, their values were different. What were the values were different? That they were spiritually minded people. Whereas the Nawab was not spiritually minded. So he thought that I'm doing them a big favor. I gave them such position, such power. So you can see in relationship, any relationship, if you see over here, there is this component of what we do for others and what others do for us. So now, in any relationship, there is always this contribution and there is some expectation. So when there is both, there's something substantial we do for others and there's something substantial others do for us. So what we do for others is often demanding, but when they are reciprocating, then it becomes rewarding. But if what we do for others is more than what they do for us, now this may actually be more than what we do for us, or well, this may be actually more, or it may be that it appears more, it appears too much. I'm doing so much for you. So because different people have different value systems, I'll come to that. But when what we do for others seems much more and what others are doing for us seems too little, then it's demanding for us. If others are doing a lot for us and we are not doing anything for them, or they feel it that way, then it becomes demanding for them. And if nobody is doing anything for anyone, then it's demanding. People start thinking, why am I here at all? What am I? Why should I be spending my time in this? So now, what happened was, Rupa and Sanatan Goswamis, they had done a great sacrifice. But the problem was, so sacrifice was unappreciated. Why unappreciated? Because their value systems were different. The Goswamis valued spirituality, valued devotion, and the Nawab valued material gains, material things. So the Goswamis actually gave up their devotion to a large extent. They gave up the devotional culture in which they were living to a large extent. They were Brahmanas. They had changed over. They had been forced to convert, because in those times, if we consider the past when people lived, largely every situation required of commitment at that time. Say, if you join a company, then what happens is the company may ask us to sign some documents that we will not leak the secrets of the company elsewhere. So similarly, at that time, what happened was the value systems were so different that if one wanted political commitment, political or managerial commitment, that's what he wanted. He didn't really care much. But he was an Islamic ruler, and I cannot have anyone who is not Islamic in my administration. So for political or managerial commitment, he required religious conversion. And it was a great sacrifice for Rupa Sanatana Goswami. And in fact, that is one of the reasons why they never became sannyasis. Because in the society at that time, if somebody had converted to Islam, then they were considered to have become contaminated by that. And they would not be given. They had lost their Brahminical status, so they couldn't get sannyas. But the Goswamis were renounced, and that's how they took a Babaji Vesh. They became renounced in that way. But in this case, what had happened was, the Goswamis had sacrificed their spirituality. And they had material comforts and material power, but they didn't really value that much. Because for them, Turnavat, it was insignificant. But for the Nawab, he thought, I had given you so much, and you are abandoning me for what? For the religion which you said you had renounced, you had converted from. So for him, for the Nawab, the Goswami's devotion was not just a distraction. Goswami's devotion was a betrayal for him. Because for him, what happened was, their conversion to his religion was the sign of their loyalty to him. And he says, you want to give up all that I am doing, all that I have given you opportunity to do for becoming religiously devoted? He considered that as a betrayal. And Prince Sanatan Goswami was imprisoned because of that. And this was a problem in autocratic systems, that if the king is the ruler, there's one authority, then that one authority decision becomes final, and there is no court of appeal beyond that. So he jailed Sanatan Goswami. And when Sanatan Goswami was jailed, at that time what happened was, there's no chance for him to come out unless he agreed to give up his desire to renounce the world. And therefore, now Sanatana Goswami was not going to do that. And even if he did that, he would have to earn the trust of the Nawab back again. So the Nawab jailed Sanatana Goswami, and he went off. Now, he was not into administration. He was more into expansion. He wanted to conquer more territories and have that ego trip that I rule so much. I have such a large kingdom. But who's going to maintain the kingdom? Somebody has to do that. So for him, the Rupa Sanatana Goswami were very important tools. He said, I'll maintain the kingdom. You maintain the kingdom. I will expand the kingdom. So he went off, and then Sanatana Goswami used various intrigues to get out of there. So, what did Sanatana Goswami have to do? Actually, here we see the determination of Sanatana Goswami. That in the Bhagavad Gita, it is said that even for great devotees, satatam kirtayanto mam yatantash dudavrataha, that it requires great determination to be devoted to the Lord. So, we know determination is, we need determination because our senses are distracted, our mind is distracted. But for the great devotees, it's not like that. So we have to overcome both inner and outer challenges. So if we live in a country which largely has religious freedom, we may not have much religious, much outer challenges. Of course, we live in a world of temptation. So there are outer challenges. But there are outer challenges which even great devotees faced. So he had to create a whole story. And what are the story he created? He said, actually, I want to go to a holy place. And here there is a principle that comes up. So there are two ideas about ethics. Ethics can either be categorical or contextual. Categorical means to speak truth is good. To speak untruth is bad. These are two categories. And that is fine. But what about considering consequences? What about considering intent? If somebody is rioting and our friend is hiding from those rioters, and those rioters ask us, do you know where your friend is? If you tell the truth, life will be lost. So there is contextual ethics. That means for a higher purpose, sometimes less than optimal means can be used, less than ideal means can be used. So contextual ethics means consider context. So what are the context here? There was no way Sanatana Goswami could escape if he focused on honesty. So for him, the honesty was important, more than honesty, it is truthfulness. Truthfulness was important, but the absolute truth was even more important for him. The absolute truth is that we are ultimately parts of the Lord. We are meant to serve the Lord. We are playing some part over here in this world. So he created a whole story. How I want to go to a holy place. His purpose was definitely to go to a holy place. But he had to persuade them. Persuade his jailers. So he told them, I'm going to go to a holy place that they will value. Not a holy place that he would value. And then he offered him some excuse by how he could get away from the Nawab. He offered him some financial allurement, and this way he escaped. So it was a great risk for his life, because that person who was a minister, who was the most poor, you see how fortune changes in this world. The same person who was, what was the adversity that he faced? The change of fortune was this person who was the most powerful, one of the most powerful persons in the kingdom, was now a fugitive, running for his life, from a minister to a fugitive. And he did all this just because he wanted to be a devotee. He wanted to serve the Lord. And he was a fugitive persecuted by one of the most tyrannical persons of those times. And he had to accept that. So there was material misfortune, you could say. But that material fortune was the way to spiritual fortune for him. So what was the spiritual fortune? He wanted to reach Lord Chaitanya. He wanted to absorb himself in devotion. And he accepted that. It was a very risky journey to actually get to where he needed to be, to reach Lord Chaitanya, to reach the Lord. What happened is, so he had this adventures in renunciation. What were the adventures in renunciation? That first he had to, for him, his worldly profession was a distraction from his devotion. And he decided, no, I cannot have this distraction. I want to focus entirely on devotion. Then there was danger for his life as he went. He was in the Bengal area, and from Bengal. Bengal is on the eastern coast of India. And he wanted to meet Lord Chaitanya, who was in the northern part at that time, who was in Varanasi. So he had to walk. And first, he was a fugitive in the kingdom of the Nawab. And there were various attempts, threats to his life. He had to give up all his possessions. He had an attendant with him. He eventually renounced that attendant because that attendant couldn't renounce everything. wanted to, for Sanatan Goswami, his security was his faith in the Lord. But his attendant wanted financial security. He was not satisfied with spiritual security. And what happened over here is, Sanatan Goswami recognized that, now what happens is, we often don't realize how differing value systems change perceptions. We don't see things as they are. We see things as they matter to us. So we don't see things as they are. Nobody sees things as they are. We are just not designed like that. We see things as they matter to us. So we go into a room. As soon as we go into a room, depending on what matters, if we have if it's a hotel where we are staying and we had a long travel journey, the first thing we look is there a comfortable bed? Is the ventilation good? Is the heating good? So then you can just tourism or sightseeing, we will see, okay, what kind of view is there from the window? What kind of atmosphere is here? If we are going to a hotel and if somebody wants to party over there, then they will see what kind of facilities are there for partying. If we go to a spiritual place and we're looking for spiritual things, then we will see who are there some spiritual people over here. So what we see things as they matter to us. So what happened was, Sanatan Goswami, for him, he realized that financial security was bringing him insecurity. How is that possible? Because he was just traveling alone, and when people suspected that he might be having some money, they would try to threaten him and they would try to kill him. So he said, his servant had some gold coins, some precious things, and he just gave it to one of the bartenders, one of the innkeepers along the way. He said, if you don't take it, somebody else will take it from me. So what happened was, for him, there is only now the devotional security. Devotional security is what? That I am in the Lord's hands. You know, that Tesham Aham Samudharta Mrityu Samsar Sagarat Bhavami Nachirat Partha Mai Aveshit Chetasam. That I will be delivered by my Lord. If I just fix my mind on Him, that the Lord knows what is best for us better than we do. So this is the essence of devotional faith or devotional security. The Lord knows better than us what is best for us. So this is not a very easy faith to have. Even if we can't have this faith, if we just have faith that things happen for a purpose, that also is a step forward. So for him, he renounced all material security and he moved on. And finally, after a very difficult and dangerous journey, he reached Lord Chaitanya. And because he had been living as a Muslim person and he was traveling through parts of the world which were ruled by Muslims, so he had dressed up also, he appeared like a Muslim. So what happened was, now again, and there's nothing specifically, this is not a criticism of Islam in any way. Islam is a very broad religion, a very big religion in the world. And like in every religion, there are people in the modes of goodness, passion, and ignorance. There are broad-minded people, there are narrow-minded people, there are intolerant people in every religious tradition. So at that particular time, the religious tradition, and especially the rulers of that religious tradition, were intolerant. So he was dressed like that. And Lord Chaitanya. So when he reached Lord Chaitanya, Lord Chaitanya, the super soul in the heart. So he said that, no, is there a great devotee who has come out there? And the Lord Chaitanya attendant went there, the host and went outside. And he said, no, there's nobody over there. There's no devotee out there. So then, is there someone out there? He asked him. So, yeah, there seems to be a Muslim mendicant over there. Okay, bring him inside. And when he came inside, Lord Chaitanya embraced him. So Lord Chaitanya didn't see the substance. He didn't see the appearance. He saw the substance beyond the appearance. He saw the heart. See, the world sees us outside in. It looks at how we'll appear, and then if we appear respectable, if we appear attractive, if we appear as if we have something of value, then people may want to know us more. And then they will look at what is inside us. But the Lord sees us inside out. So he knew what was there in Sanatana Goswami's heart. And what did he do? He moved forward and he immediately embraced Sanatana Goswami. The Lord Chaitanya was a sannyasi. And this is a time when the caste boundaries had become quite stratified in Indian society. Although the Bhakti tradition opposed those, but still they were quite stratified. And for such a person, for sannyasi to actually embrace someone, to embrace anyone was unusual. Sannyasis don't embrace anyone so commonly. But for him to embrace this unknown person who looked like a Muslim mendicant, that was extraordinary. But Lord Chaitanya didn't see it all. And the Lord Chaitanya, all the people around him were bewildered. And the Lord Chaitanya introduced him. This is Sanatana Goswami. He's a great devotee. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu started glorifying him. And then Sanatana Goswami told his whole story about what all he had to do to come to Lord Chaitanya's shelter. And now, at this point, the reaction of Lord Chaitanya is extraordinary. Normally, if somebody goes through great adversity and adventure, now it was adventure in renunciation, in the sense that if somebody had been materialistic, they would not have considered it as adventure. They would consider it a disaster. No, I lost my wealth. I almost lost my life. I'm penniless. But because his focus was on devotion, was on gaining inner enrichment through devotion, on gaining the mercy of the Lord, so he didn't feel anything as a disaster. He said, oh, this is a way for me to turn away more and more from all the distracting things of the world and go deeper and deeper into my relationship with the Lord. So for Sanatana Goswami, it was an adventure in devotion, an adventure in renunciation that led to devotion. But then when Lord Chaitanya heard about all his adventurous story, he could have appreciated him. Oh, how much you sacrifice, O Sanatana Goswami, that who can be as renounced as you? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did do that, but he did that in a slightly different way. What did he say? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu attributed it all to the super soul, which is interesting. He said, the super soul has been very merciful to you. So that despite having so much wealth, so he said the mercy of the Lord is that amid so much opulence, you could have so much renunciation. That is the mercy of the Lord. Now, normally, we may think of mercy as if we get a lot of opulence, that's what we may think as mercy. But the Lord said, okay, ultimately, what is mercy? What is purification? What is transformation? See, the essence of transformation, you know, transformation is transformation of values. And now, what do we mean by values? Values are not just abstract things. You know, okay, this person has good values, this person has bad values. Values simply refers to what we value. So we could say that what we consider valuable reflects our values. So what we consider valuable reflects our values. And so what Lord Chaitanya is saying over here, that although you had so much wealth which the world considers valuable, but you realize the value of devotion and you are ready to risk even your life and renounce everything else for this, that indicates that you have received the mercy of the Lord. So mercy is ultimately transformation of values. Mercy is not just as like somebody touches us and we feel some electric light going through our body, or we close our eyes and we see some mystical vision. Well, those things may happen to some people, but those are just, if at all they are, they are not hallucinations, and there may be some kind of some mystical experiences. But more than mystical experiences, what we want is an elevated state of consciousness. An elevated state of consciousness centers around the transformation of values. So the transformation of values is the essence of mercy. How do we know that somebody has received the mercy of the Lord? When what they value starts changing. The same things that we felt we would not be able to live without. Oh, it may be TV watching, it may be overeating, oversleeping, it may be gossiping. Then suddenly we find, hey, this doesn't make any sense. Why should I spend time on this? There's so much more to do in my life. So if our values change, that indicates we have received mercy. If we value the opportunity to hear about the Lord, if we learn to value the opportunity to speak about the Lord, to share His message, to chant His holy names, to do bhakti, that is indicating that we have received mercy. So is it our determination? I will give this up and I will take that up. Well, definitely our determination is a part of it. But the transformation doesn't happen only by our determination. There is that our determination plays a part, but the transformation is what happens by the Lord's grace. And this is where we could say there is a difference between determination and purification. So what is the difference between these two things? So we can say growth in devotion. So growth in devotion happens in different ways. So there is, we could say first is there's determination. Determination means even if I'm attracted to something non-devotional, I will resist. That is determination. Purification means I'm no longer attracted to anything non-devotional. So that's purification. And ultimately for us, we want not just purification, but absorption. I lose myself in my Lord. That is the ultimate thing that we want in our lives. So this is from determination through purification to absorption. So adav shraddha. So shraddha is favorable curiosity. Shraddha, saddha, sadhu sangha, bhajana kriya, anartha nirutti. So like that, we move forward in the stages. So determination is required right in the beginning. To start off the practice of bhakti, to start off associating with devotees, to start off doing bhajana kriya. But from then, anartha nivritti happens. And then, nishtha, ruchi, asakti, bhava, prem. We move that way in the relationship, in our relationship with the Lord. So this is how advancement happens. And now, determination is something which we can strive to have. I don't feel like doing this, but I will do it. That's determination. However, purification, when that the attraction to worldly things itself disappears, that's not in our hands. That happens by the Lord's grace. And absorption, when the Lord reveals His attractiveness to us and we just put aside everything else for His sake, that comes entirely by His mercy. So that's why these are progressive stages. And we can't, we shouldn't think that I have become pure. Rather, the law by Lord's mercy has made me pure. So determination we try to master as much as we can, but purification and absorption come by the Lord's grace. And in this way, Lord Chaitanya, again, he didn't only accept him, embrace him, but Lord Chaitanya also instructed him. Instructed him, see, the greatest mercy is, mercy can come in many installments. If you want to understand the principle of mercy, actually, we can say that installments of mercy. Now, mercy is sometimes we have this idea that when will I receive the mercy of the Lord? Will I ever get mercy of the Lord? If we say I don't get the mercy of the Lord, then does that mean the Lord is not merciful? So the mercy of the Lord is analog, not digital. That means analog, digital means it's not just 1-0. That we have the mercy, we don't have the mercy. No, we have degrees of mercy. So, just the opportunity for bhakti is itself mercy. So, Sanatana Goswami got this opportunity when he was able to renounce the worldly shackles, or even before that, when he was able to create some space for himself amid the worldly situations. So that was mercy. But opulence in bhakti can be various things, is also mercy. So opulence can be that somebody becomes expert in a particular service, they can speak beautifully, they can sing wonderfully, they can decorate the deities very nicely, they develop an extraordinary level of sense control and renunciation. Opulence in bhakti is greater mercy, we could say. Actually, but humility in bhakti is the greatest mercy. Because why is humility the greatest mercy? Because when we have humility, we no longer stay caught in self-consciousness, but we can offer our entire consciousness to Krishna. Otherwise, we may have opulence in bhakti, we may be able to sing very well, speak very well, but what are we thinking? How great I am, how powerful I am. And when thinking in that way, then we are not really growing much in bhakti, because we are not offering our consciousness to the Lord. So humility is the greatest mercy. And what was Lord Chaitanya doing? He was helping Sanatana Goswami see this. That yes, you renounced, and that is glorious. But don't think it is your glory. It is ultimately the Lord's glory. It is the super soul in the heart who has been merciful to you. And Sanatana Goswami, with appreciating, with the disarming humility, he says, actually, I don't know who the super soul is. I don't know who Krishna is. I only know who you are, my Lord. I only know who you are. And I surrender my life to you. And now, Sanatana Goswami, when he had been coming on his way, what had happened was, at that, along the way, he had met one of his friends, one of his relatives, Srikant. And he had said, you know, oh, why are you living like this? You are a minister. Why are you living like a pauper? You stay with me. I will help you live in comfort. He said, no. I don't want to live. I want to go to Lord Chaitanya. Then he said, okay, at least take something from me. So he had given him an expensive blanket. And Sanatana Goswami had that blanket. Now what happens is sometimes, you know, we are unmindful. We are unaware of perceptions. That means we are often so caught in our thought that we don't think about how people perceive us. Now, should we worry about how people perceive us? Well, yes and no. The principle is, be mindful of others' perceptions, but don't make your mind full of others' perceptions. We need to be aware. See, we don't live as an island. We live in a society, we live in a community. We can't be blind to how people perceive us. Don't let your mind become full of people's perceptions. So we can't let everything that we do be defined by how the world perceives us. But we need to be aware of how the world perceives us. Why? Because how the world perceives us determines how the world receives us. Now, if the world perceives us as, say, for example, in the Western world, if people perceive us, oh, you are just an Indian group, then most people will say, only people who are interested in something Indian culture or Indian group, they will come to us. But if they see us, okay, we are spiritual people. Oh, I want to be spiritual. I want to learn from you. So we have to be aware of how people perceive us. How people perceive us determines how people receive us. Receive means how much they are receptive to us. So what happened with this is, Sanatana Goswami was just so happy to be with the Lord that he was unmindful that his blanket, which he had, was out of sync with this, with the way he was living. He was a mendicant and he had this very expensive blanket with him. He was not even thinking about that expensive blanket. It is just, okay, when it gets cold, I have this blanket with me. But he didn't even bother about it. He had no thoughts about it. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was looking at it repeatedly. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is also so sensitive. He's the Lord, but what happens is he doesn't condemn Sanatana Goswami, he doesn't correct him immediately. The Lord is also sensitive. So here it's important that we be sensitive. So what happens is, just because we are right doesn't give us the right to correct others. We have to have the relationship. We may have to earn the right through developing the relationship. Generally, what happens is whenever anybody corrects us, why are you correcting me like this? What's going on over here? It's not, never pleasant to be corrected. So just being right doesn't give us the right to correct others. We have to earn the right. And although Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is God, although Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the person through whom Sanatana Goswami has surrendered, is not just some God who exists somewhere. Sanatana Goswami accepts him as his be-all and end-all. And yet Chaitanya Mahaprabhu doesn't directly condemn or chastise him. Just looks repeatedly at the blanket. And now Sanatana Goswami is also astute. He's so devotionally absorbed that he's a little oblivious at this time. But he's also astute. He understands that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is not pleased with me. Maybe I shouldn't have this blanket. And he goes to a beggar on the Varanasi river banks. And he says, oh, you have this torn quilt. Can you give that to me and you can have this blanket? He says, are you making fun of me? Who would do an exchange like this? But for Sanatana Goswami, the basis for the exchange was not the material value, but the spiritual value. He said he was not concerned about how valuable the blanket was. He was concerned with what will please the Lord. And what will please the Lord, he wanted to do it. And he said, no, I'm in earnest. Just take this blanket. And he gave his blanket to him and then he took the torn quilt. And when he came back to Lord Chaitanya asked him, hey, what happened to your blanket? And he told us what had happened. Lord Chaitanya was very pleased. Lord Chaitanya embraced him and blessed him. And then after that, Lord Chaitanya gave him instructions. Elaborate instructions on the process of bhakti, which forms several chapters in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. So it is what this conveys. This is the concluding point we'll have, and then we can have a couple of questions. That when we get wisdom, instruction is a result of reciprocation. The Lord instructs those who are ready, and he has his own tests about who are ready. So we can only help the unable, not the unwilling. Not the unwilling means if somebody doesn't want to be helped, then we can't help them. No matter what we do, sometimes in India, if a car is not working, a car is not turning on, then the driver may ask others for help, and other people will come and they will push the car from behind. And as people try to push the car from behind, the person is trying to steer the wheel from inside. Then together the car starts off. But suppose people are pushing the car from outside and somebody inside is just sleeping, has gone to sleep. Or worse still, somebody inside is actively braking the car. Then the people outside say, why should we keep pushing? So what happens is people outside can push to a certain extent. Pushing a car that doesn't work, it requires work. And the work is required by both the person inside and the people outside. So similarly, when we try to give instructions to anyone, there has to be some reciprocation, some willingness. They should be, maybe they're not able to do it, but if they're unwilling to do it, then we can't really help them. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was testing Sanatana Goswami's willingness. How much is he willing to renounce? So when he saw that he's ready to take a hint, that you want to be instructed, you want to be guided, then the Lord gave him much more guidance. So the same principle applies in our lives also. Sometimes we may be confused in this situation. What should I do? What should I not do? So when we are in confused situations, so if we are confused, what can we do? So do what is clear to us. Now, what is clear to us means that we may be confused, you know, should I stay in this place or that place? Should I take up this job or that job? Should I form a relationship with this person or that person? And spiritually, should I become initiated by this spiritual master or that spiritual master? So what we can do is do what is clear to us. That means there are certain things which we have to do, whatever else we do. We do our sadhana, we do our study of scriptures. This is vital, this is universal. So we show the Lord we want to be guided. The things which we know we should be doing, that if we do that, if we do those things, what we know is right. So what will happen by that? If we do what is clear to us, what we know is right, by this we show the Lord that we want to be guided, then He will make the unclear clear for us. That's how the Lord works. He's reciprocal. So Tesham Satata Yuktanam Bhajatam Priti Purvakam Tadami Buddhi Yogam Tam Yenamam Upayantite. In this way, the Lord says, if you are devoted to me, then I will give you the wisdom by which you can come to me, by which you can make the right choices, by which you can come to me. And that is the Lord's promise. So when he saw Sanatana Goswami ready to receive instructions by his willingness to obey and hinted instruction, the Lord opened his heart and enriched him with instructions, with wisdom. That has become a legacy for generations and generations of devotees to come. That has become of the part of the central canon of Gaudiya Vaishnavism. So this is how Lord Chaitanya tested and blessed Sanatana Goswami. So I'll summarize what I spoke and we can have a few questions. So today I spoke on this theme of learning from Lord Chaitanya's interactions with Sanatana Goswami, and talk about three themes broadly: adversity, adventure, and advancement. So Sanatana Goswami, what was the adversity? He'd taken a selfless service of being a shock absorber, a buffer between the tyrannical Islamic ruler and the pious, devoted culture of the times in Bengal. But eventually, when he had it enough, he wanted to offer his life to Lord Chaitanya, he faced difficulty. So adversities are especially unbearable when we feel we have done nothing to deserve them. When we have done something good and something bad happens to us. So that's what happened. He wanted to offer his life to the Lord and he was imprisoned and he had to find various ways to come out of it. So we talked about the four quadrants, that if two people have different value systems, then each person may feel, I am doing so much for you. And other person feels, you're not doing anything for me. So if what we value, what we do for others is more than what we feel others are doing for us, then the relationship starts becoming a drain. It becomes demanding for us, and vice versa from the other perspective also. So Sanatana Goswami had sacrificed a lot to serve the Nawab. But the Nawab felt that I have given you so much. How can you renounce this all? And you betray me. You are converted to our religion and you are going to your own holy place and you want to do your bhakti and give up my responsibilities. He imprisoned him. And Sanatana Goswami had to subordinate truth to the absolute truth. Truth with a lowercase to absolute truth with a upper A and upper T, uppercase T. So, and then he managed to escape. And there also he had great risks. He risked his life. And finally he reached the Lord. And when Lord Chaitanya saw him, Lord Chaitanya saw beyond his appearance to his substance. He had a heart of gold, heart filled with devotion. Lord Chaitanya embraced him. And then Sanatana Goswami had done so much sacrifice, risked his life itself. He had given up all material security. From a prisoner, from a minister, he had become a fugitive. From a wealthy person, he had become a pauper. He had given up all financial security and put faith in the Lord. So it was glorious what he had done. Lord Chaitanya didn't just glorify him. He said, the super soul has been very merciful to you. And in that, we discussed that There are various degrees of mercy. Mercy is not digital, it's analog. So just to have the opportunity for devotion is mercy. To gain some opulence in devotion is a greater mercy. But to have humility in devotion is the greatest mercy. And determination is something which we can try to muster by our effort. But purification, determination means we keep doing the right thing and avoiding the wrong things, even if our feelings don't go with us. But purification means that we are no longer attracted to worldly things, to unworthy temporary things. And absorption means that we get completely attracted spontaneously toward the Lord. So that's the progression. So determination may come by our effort, but purification in terms of the change of our values, that comes by the Lord's mercy. So then lastly, by Sanatana Goswami is giving up his blanket. What is being taught over here is that the Lord gives his mercy in extraordinary ways. And but what is the principle? It is that reciprocity. When Sanatana Goswami took the hint and he gave up his blanket, he had not even thought about that blanket because he was so absorbed in ecstasy of being with the Lord. But he saw the Lord in his place, he gave it up immediately. And that pleased the Lord. So in our lives also, when we feel confused, if we keep in mind that what is clear for me, let me do that. Then what I know is right, if I do it, then we will be guided by the Lord from within. And that way, from the confusing situations, we can come to clearer understanding of what to do. And how Lord Chaitanya guided also is instructive. Although he's God, he didn't condemn Chit Sanatana Goswami's having a expensive blanket. So just because we are right doesn't give us the right to correct others. We need to earn that right by our spirit, by investing in that relationship. So thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Are there any questions or reflections?
Sure, I have a question. Thank you so much for being here with us. Hare Krishna. I really appreciated all the things you were sharing about relationships, and in particular that graph that you showed about it was something like you kind of showed the parallels between giving to others and others and receiving from others as well. I thought that was really nice. And just the correlations you made between Santanand Goswami and Lord Chaitanya, of course. But my particular question has to do with one particular slide that you had mentioned, that we should resist anything that's non-devotional, and that is our determination. And the second part of that slide that I remember was that in due time, there will be absorption, or actually, I think that was the last part, but the middle part after determination was
purification.
What's that?
Purification.
Yes, purification. Yes, and in due time, there will be purification, and we would no longer feel that attraction toward non-devotional things, and eventually there would be a complete absorption in the Lord. So I was wondering if you could elaborate more specifically on what you meant by what was considered non-devotional things, and how can we resist them, considering that we are actually, especially for those that live outside of the temple, we are all constantly bombarded by quote unquote non-devotional things. That's it for now.
So actually, there's definitely, that requires explanation. And thank you for asking this question. Basically, I would say there are two distinct things over here which need to be understood, that when we talk about non-devotional, it's not again black and white. It is a matter of progression. So we can say broadly there are three things. There is working with material desires, there is working for material desires, there is working on material desires. Now this might seem a little complicated. I just have a PowerPoint slide which I'll show you quickly. that will make things a little clearer. So the point is that we all have certain desires, and not every worldly desire is necessarily against the principles of bhakti. There are some desires which are contrary to the principles of bhakti, and those which are contrary, we have to be careful about them. But working with material desires means that we have certain desires, we can't give them up right now, but that doesn't mean that they become our driving or defining desires. We work with whatever desires we have without necessarily making them grow. So there are certain desires which go directly against our devotional principles. So for example, we can say eating meat. If you want to develop love for the Lord, how can we develop love for the Lord if we are actually killing his children? Those living beings which are his parts, if we are killing them, then we might say that I have love for the Lord, but it's actually a little utopian to say that. It's not very deep in that case. So the idea is that for each of us, when we want to develop the love for the Lord, it is important that we recognize that we have to move forward gradually. So what can we do about it? We just take it step by step. So rather than trying to, in the bhakti, we don't have to focus on what we have to give up. We focus on what we want to take up. If you keep right things, gradually giving up the unwanted things will become much easier. So if don't worry too much about what we have to give up. Focus on what we have to take up. Take up means what is it that I want to do in my spiritual life? And as I focus on that more and more, what needs to be given up will automatically happen. So the idea is take things step by step. And step by step means that there are, just like if you consider a relationship. In general, if you want to develop a relationship, what do we need? We need to consider what the other person likes. And we do those things. The things which the other person doesn't like, we avoid those things. That's what, and if the other person is also is a good person, they have good value system, then trying to please them will actually make us better. It will help us. It will also help us grow. It will help us understand that, okay, these things are something which I needn't be doing. So same principle applies in our relationship with the Lord also. It's not just a matter of following rules. It's understanding that I want to please the Lord. So we don't see that, okay, what are the things which will please the Lord? I do that. So let's look at it this way. See, when we want to deal with our worldly desires, there are three things. There is working for them. Working for them means that our life is defined by trying to fulfill those desires. So some people, for them, lust and greed and anger, they think these are sources of power and pleasure. That's working for them. Working with them means, okay, I have these desires. It's not that I'm actively fueling them. I'm not creating fantasies in my mind. And I'm not fueling those. Fantasies might arise, but I'm not fueling them actively. And is working on them. Okay, I have these desires. We can't wish them away. So I work on them. Work on them means we are trying to purify and redirect our desires. So generally speaking, as devotees, we try to avoid this first quadrant. Working for them. Now that also depends, because sometimes some desires may be very strong and we may have to work for them for some time till we can get rid of them. But generally, we try to avoid that. So if we consider even the devatas, they have sensual desires. The asuras, the demons also have some sensual desires. But though the godly and ungodly both have sensual desires, the difference is the godly don't live for those sensual desires. They follow the Lord, Vishnu Bhakta Smita Deva Asurastad Viparya. They follow the Lord, and while following the Lord, they also want fulfillment of their desires. But they're not living for those desires only. That doesn't define and drive their life. So when I talk about change of values as devotees, our focus needs to be on this. In the third part, working on them. That means practicing bhakti to purify and redirect our desires. So we focus on redirecting our desires. Not that I don't want to do this. This is what I want to do. I want to be with devotees. I want to spend more time in association. I want to spend more time learning scripture. When we have focus, then gradually we'll be able to connect with the other things will fall in place. So the more we cultivate healthy desires, the more unhealthy desires will go away. Because it's very difficult to say no to things. Saying no is never pleasurable. I conclude with an example. That say suppose somebody invites us for some party or some get together and we're not really interested. But if they're inviting us, we may want to say no, but we have to think of what excuse will I say to say no or what reason will I come up with. But if at that time we have another engagement, then it becomes relatively easier to say no. I have to do this. So similarly for us, if you think I will not do this, that's difficult to do, to say no to any desire. We try to find out something to say yes to, and then saying no to things becomes much easier by that. So in bhakti, there are many things we can say yes to, and we can find out some things which we like within bhakti, and we can keep saying yes to them. We may like to cook for the Lord. We may like to do some book distribution for the Lord. We may like to recite verses. We may like to share his message. We may like to hear classes. Find what we like to do and strengthen that desire. And gradually, that desire will help us, will become the engine for our inner transformation. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. But it also leads to other questions. So I'll ask if anybody else has any questions. And if
I have a question.
Yes, please.
Please accept my humble obeisances, Prabhuji. Thank you for the wonderful class. My question is that how do we differentiate between beating oneself up over things and so low self-esteem over humility? How to differentiate humility from the other feelings?
Oh, okay. That is the key difference between humility and beating ourselves is when we are beating ourselves, we are devaluing ourselves. The essence of humility is not devaluing ourselves. It is valuing something bigger than ourselves. The essence of humility is not devaluing ourselves. It is on valuing something bigger than ourselves. Humility means to not let out. So I write on the Bhagavad Gita every day. An article at GitaDaily.com. That's my website. So I'll just share the link to an article over here. So these are all articles on humility on GitaDaily.com. There are about 35 articles on humility itself. So you can just search for humility over there. You'll get it. But here, humility means to not let our ego come in the way of our purpose. So we all have to, what do we want to do in our lives? Humility is not so much about what are the things which I do it wrong or what are things I'm incapable of doing. What are things which I mess up things? That's not the essence of humility. Humility means that there are some things so important in my life that I will not let my ego come in the way of those things. Humility means to not let our ego come in the way of our purpose. If our purpose is beating ourselves up, that is not humility. We all have a purpose. The Lord has made all of us as his parts. And we all have a thing to do. We all have something valuable to contribute. The Lord loves us. That's why he's there with us in our hearts. He treasures us. So when we lack humility, we become puppets of our ego. So that means if I am not respected, why should I do this thing? Well, respect or disrespect can be one factor we consider. And now when I'm talking about respect and disrespect, it can be not just others' respect and disrespect. It's also our. Humility is not lack of self-respect. Humility is lack of self-absorption. Self-absorption is I'm always thinking of myself. Now, if we don't respect ourselves, we are actually not respecting a part of God. So to disrespect ourselves is to disrespect God ultimately. Not that we are God, but we are parts of God. So we cannot be disrespectful to ourselves if we are parts of God. So humility is not lack of self-respect. It is lack of self-absorption or self-obsession. Where I think, I'm so bad. I can't do this. I made a mess of that. Okay, I did those things. But still, God loves me. Still, Krishna is there in my heart with me. And still, every day offers a fresh chance for me. Let me take that. So humility means two things. It is not to have a meaningful purpose and not let our ego come in the way of the purpose. And humility is not lack of self-esteem. It is lack of self-esteem or self-respect. It is lack of self-obsession. So I'll post a link for this in the Zoom chat, this article. And if you want, you can subscribe for these Gita Daily articles also. I write an article. You might find that helpful also.
Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Are there any other questions? Do we have time? Depends.
Sure. They want me to ask another question, so I'll ask. Thank you. One thing that you had mentioned was taking care of cows. And so, obviously, as devotees and Vaishnavas, we want to take care of all living entities. And there seems to be a limit to all the living entities that we can take care of. So what would you say, I mean, how is that line drawn? Because... you know, sometimes we kill roaches or we kill other things because they're, invading our space. Or so in a way there can be the argument made that, at what point who determines where that line is drawn? I think that's a decent question.
Are you talking specifically about cows or are you talking about everybody, people in general? Means is it for cow care or in general, how much do we extend ourselves for others? Is that what your question is?
Well, I mean, it's just like, for example, the Jains, right? Jains won't eat carrots or potatoes. So just different traditions and different people. Yeah.
Okay, so that's... So when we take care of, we say we take care of cows, so to what extent do we go in that direction? Say, for example, Jains may want to avoid far more things than what we do. Even we consider vegans, they avoid even all animal products. So even with caring for other life forms, what are there any limits to what we go? Yes, that's an important question. There is always a danger in pursuing any value. The nature of the mind is that whatever it values, it tends to make it the supreme value. Whatever the mind values, it tends to make it the supreme value. So it can happen to things which are not too important. Some people become sports fans and they become obsessed with sports. So similarly, people can become obsessed with trivial things. Sometimes somebody can become obsessed with even with valuable things, but they may not be supreme value. So yes, non-violence or non-violence toward animals or non-violence toward all living beings. That's an important principle. True. And certainly we don't want to hurt animals in any way. At the same time, that is not the supreme value. Why is it not the supreme value? Because ultimately what can we do? Death is inevitable in this world. Distress is inevitable in the world. Jivo jivasya jivanam. That one life form is the food for another life form. that was what, as a famous Western poet, he said that nature is sometimes seen as this very beautiful, benevolent being. But nature is red in tooth and claw. Say, red in tooth and claw means nature can be brutal. One life, survival of the fittest, as Darwin talked about. So the point is that we cannot live in isolated from our ecosystem. We cannot be the odd man out, completely distancing ourselves. So we live in a symbiotic universe. And we try to harmonize ourselves as much as possible with nature. So, but what is natural? Ultimately, it is, if we want to say we want to live naturally, what does it mean? So animals don't really have any kind of culture. We human beings have culture. The purpose is not just to live naturally, the purpose is to live spiritually. And we live naturally to the extent we can live spiritually. So if you want to say I live only naturally, then in nature, animals don't wear clothes. So do we want to live like that? We may say that's natural, but that won't be very spiritual. That will be, it'll make us obsessed with worldly desires and worldly passions, worldly cravings. So just because something is natural doesn't necessarily make it spiritual. And sometimes something which is spiritual require us to restrain that which is natural, because we also have a lower nature. So we may have a nature to get angry, but we try to behave in a courteous, respectful way with others. We try to be humble. So what are the limits? Well, we can generally, rather than focusing on what are the limits, focus on what is the purpose. So if somebody is going on a road, no, can I steer? How far can I steer on the left? How far can I steer on the right? Well, the point is, where do you want to go? Why can't I go on this? Why can't I go steer to the left? Why can't I go in this alley? Why can't I go in that bypass? Well, where do you want to go? That's the important thing. So focus on the purpose, and then the path becomes clear. Otherwise, we have every crossroad that we come to, we think, oh, should I go here? Should I go there? Where do I want to go? So for us, ultimately, our purpose is to spiritualize our consciousness. And those who think that now we will live completely free from violence, well, that's good. But how far can we go in that? Will we not take medicines? So for example, if we take antibiotics when we are sick, what is an antibiotic basically? It's a systematic killing machine. It's a killing tablet or killing medicine. It's a machine. It doesn't seem like a machine to us in terms of having multiple parts, but it is a mechanical thing which kills. The doctors, from a perspective, we say they're saviors of our life, but from the perspective of bacteria and other parasitical forms, pathogenic thing, the doctors are systematic killers, trained killers. Well, are they trained killers? Well, no, they're not going about killing life. They're going about saving life. And for the purpose of saving life, life has to be killed. What can we do? In general, when we say that this world is a place of distress, dukkhalaya, what it means is not that everybody has to be always miserable. It means that it can mean many things, but one thing it means is that in this world, there are no perfect solutions. There are only tolerable trade-offs. Tolerable trade-offs. So for practically no problem in the world can we have a perfect solution. Some people want to have the perfect relationship. Well, they'll have to wait for the rest of eternity. They'll have to go back, they'll have to wait till they go back to Krishna to have a perfect relationship. So that doesn't mean that there can be lesser and greater incompatibilities in relationships. That's possible. Some people can be totally incompatible. Some people can be somewhat incompatible. Some people can be highly compatible. But there's no perfect solution, no perfect answer in the world. We only have tolerable trade-offs. So some trade-offs will be too intolerable. Some trade-offs are relatively tolerable. So for us, What is the boundary line for our deciding our tolerable trade-offs? That's based on understanding the purpose of life from scripture. So if you understand the purpose of life is to spiritualize our consciousness, then we definitely avoid nonviolence. But to what extent? To the extent that it helps us cultivate spiritual consciousness. If just trying to be nonviolent becomes obsession in itself, then we may become more obsessed on that than on being spiritual. And that will be counterproductive. So similarly, with respect to vegan, yes, some aspects of vegan are good. Let's say we don't, that animals are put to a lot of torture. At the same time, we understand that there is a reciprocity in nature. We are not using some, why should we humans use animals? Well, we're not using animals. It's a, nature has been designed in some ways to be reciprocal. So we offer something to the animals offer something to us. So that way, we don't, so I think that when the mind values one thing, it has a tendency to overvalue it and make it supreme value. So we don't want to make veganism or environmentalism or animal care into another false god. We don't want to make it into the supreme value of life. Yes, all these are valuable because they help us to spiritualize our consciousness and to approach that which is of supreme value. That is our eternal relationship with the Lord. Does it answer your question?
Yes, it does. Thank you very much. That was very, it was clear at the end. Basically, to keep our focus on our spiritual consciousness and to that degree, sort of organize our lives in that way. That makes sense. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Happy to be of service.
Hare Krishna.
Okay.
Yeah, I just have a question. Hearing you talk about Sanatana Goswami and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and I was thinking about how in our practice of Krishna consciousness, you could say we all have external, pushings in the right directions, from our spiritual teachers or from the super soul. We have some, we're impelled in certain ways. And of course, it has to be confirmed, is it actually good or not? But I'm thinking about how Sanatana Goswami, he made this big step. He gave up his position, he gave up his opulences, and he went to join Lord Chaitanya. And how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he encouraged that. And then I'm also thinking about how Srila Prabhupada, he would encourage his disciples to do certain things, like, okay, now you go to South Africa and try to establish a temple or wherever, London, here and there. So within our practices of Krishna consciousness, sometimes we may feel that we want, more of a challenge. We want to be challenged to make advancement, to make more and more advancement. But sometimes it may feel that, okay, well, how am I supposed to be challenged here? Am I supposed to challenge myself? Am I supposed to wait for others to give me the challenge? So maybe you could just comment on the idea of kind of pushing ourselves to advance more and we're kind of waiting for our gurus to kind of push us,
Okay. Maybe. So we all to sometimes need to be pushed or challenged in our spiritual lives. So how do we do that? We have to look at our teacher's own lives. If you look at Srila Prabhupada, in his books, he did emphasize follow instructions. In his personal life, he took responsibility for following the instructions he was given and for broadly fulfilling the mission that he was given. What do I mean by that? That Bhakti Saraswati Thakur told him that share spiritual knowledge in English in the Western world. And Prabhupada took responsibility for that. Now, Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur couldn't write a follow-up letter every month. What are you doing? What are you doing? No. Prabhupada was, in that sense, self-motivated. He was motivated by that instruction. But he took the responsibility. And how to go about doing that? He took his, he worked at it himself. And eventually, after he had built a significant mission in the West, he felt that he needed to spend more time in India, because here there was already a spiritual culture, and here he could create a spiritual foundation. His disciples could visit India, and apart from Indians themselves becoming devotees, they would need to become to the holy places. So he built big centers there. And Prabhupada would sometimes tell his disciples, it was my spiritual masters there to that I share Krishna Bhakti in the Western world. Now it is my desire to share Krishna Bhakti back in India again. So that, now what was Prabhupada doing? Was he doing something different from his spiritual master's instruction? No. He understood the instruction. He understood the spirit of the instruction also. Ultimately, it's not just we want to create some temples as putting a flag on Mount Everest. See, I climbed there. Prabhupada was not as interested in just building temples to be like flags. We have so many centers across the world. He wanted the temples to be transformative places where actually devotion is nourished. And he was ready to do whatever it took for that. So one limb of bhakti was to come to holy places and have their devotion enriched there. So Prabhupada created facilities, and Prabhupada created facilities in India. So it is because of Prabhupada's visionary work that now we have a movement at all, because the Western outreach has decreased to some extent. But we have Indians taking up responsibilities. And so it is Prabhupada's vision, not just his spiritual master's vision, but his own vision also, that galvanized and sustained the movement. So for each one of us, as our movement has become bigger and bigger, we may not be in a position where we may be given instructions specifically by some spiritual guide. Now, Prabhupada did say that follow instructions, but Prabhupada also said take responsibility for spiritual advancement. Prabhupada would say that we grow spiritually to the extent we take responsibilities. Now, take responsibility means what? It is not just take a responsible service. Yeah, that's important. In general, say doing a service requires, say, if somebody says, serve prasadam here. Okay, that requires some amount of attention. But okay, make sure that prasadam serving happens properly today. That means you have to take responsibility. You have to make sure how others are doing service, whether prasad is enough available or not. It requires much more absorption. So taking just doing a service is one thing. Taking responsibility for a service is a bigger thing, or for an area of service is a bigger thing. But the biggest responsibility will be taking responsibility for ourselves. What does it mean for taking responsibility for ourselves? That means that, say, suppose if we are working in some, we were working or we are working in a company, we are pursuing a career, then we would try to have a growth chart for ourselves. Where do I want to be after 5 years? Where do I want to be after 10 years? This is how I want to grow up. So there we would take responsibility. Okay, if I want to rise to this position in the company, then I need to get this, I need to learn these skills. You know, I need to do these courses. I need to develop these relationships. So we would take responsibility for our career. So if Krishna is our ultimate Lord, why should Krishna get anything less from us than what our material bosses would get from us? So we take responsibility, not in the sense of ambition, but in the sense of contribution. Not that I want a big position, but I want to make the most contribution that I can. I want to become as versatile an instrument, or as valuable an instrument in the hands of Guru and Krishna as I can. So we don't have to wait for somebody to come and give us instructions. We can, if some person who knows us, some spiritual guide who knows us well, because our movement is so big, that may not happen. But if somebody knows us well enough and they can understand our nature and they can help us give these instructions, that becomes our driving mission. That's wonderful. But if that doesn't happen, Srila Prabhupada has given us an overarching instruction: become Krishna conscious and share Krishna consciousness with others. So find out how we can do that. Take responsibility for our own selves. Okay, you know, I like to study Bhagavatam. I like to share Bhagavatam. Okay, then train yourself to become a teacher in that direction. You know, I like to guide people. Like to doesn't mean it's not, just because I like to doesn't mean it is self-gratificatory. It can be done in the mood of service. There are some things within us which call us to light, and there are many things which call us toward the dark. So if we don't respond to the things that call us to the light, we will inadvertently and inevitably respond to the call of the things that take us to the dark. So service attitude is not just following some instructions. Yes, that is there. But service attitude or devotional attitude is ultimately about responding to the things that call us to light. So there can be explicit calls to the light through the instructions that we get from the spiritual master, but there can be implicit calls by the things that we get attracted to. Anything devotional that we are attracted to is a mercy of the Lord. If you are attracted to kirtans, then try to hear kirtans more so that we can be devotionally absorbed and not get distracted. If you are attracted towards deities, then try to find ways in which you can serve the deities more and more. So that way, we can take responsibility for ourselves for becoming as versatile, as valuable an instrument for the Lord. And that's how we can create challenges for ourselves. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
So thank you very much for these thoughtful questions. I'm grateful to be of service.